धनंजय बावरी है। हम लोग 15 लोग है इस जगह में, चेन्नई में कारुक्कू एड्रेस है। हम लोग कई दिन से यहाँ पे फंसे हुए हैं, लगभग 52 डेज हुआ है हम लोग यहाँ पे फंसे हुए हैं। यहाँ पर पैसा खाना ज़्यादातर नहीं मिल रहा है, बहुत प्रॉब्लम हो चुकी है। काम स्टार्ट हो चुका है लेकिन एक दिन के बाद वो 3 दिन बैठे रहने के पड़ चुका है हम लोगों को। लेकिन ऐसे तो नहीं चलेगा, इसलिए आप ट्रेन भी नहीं चल हुआ है, घर जाने के लिए कोशिश कर रहे हैं। इसलिए कोई भी अगर हेल्प हो सके आप लोगों से, ये मैं विनती कर रहा हूँ।
तमिलनाडु सरकार हम लोग का कुछ हेल्प कीजिए, खाना उना अच्छा से नहीं मिल रहा है, पेमेंट भी 2 मंथ से नहीं मिला है, कुछ हेल्प कीजिए।
नमस्ते जी, मैं मदन कुमार महतो, मैं चेन्नई में फंस गया हूँ। चेन्नई को जो सरकार है हम लोग का, प्लीज़ हेल्प कीजिए, हम लोग का बहुत दिक्कत में है। चेन्नई में फंस गया, हम लोग का खाना बना कुछ नहीं मिल रहा है, हम लोग बहुत प्रॉब्लम में है। लेकिन कुंभ पानी चालू हुआ लेकिन 4 दिन बाद एक दिन डिबडी मिल रहा है, लेकिन हम लोग का 2 महीना से पैसा कुछ नहीं है, हम लोग के पास बहुत दिक्कत में है। लेकिन आप लोग व्यवस्था कीजिए तड़ातड़ी जल्दी से, घर जाने का बहुत हम लोग का बहुत प्रॉब्लम है, यहाँ पर फंस गया हूँ 2 महीना से।
तमिलनाडु हैज ऑलवेज बीन अ मेजर डेस्टिनेशन फॉर माइग्रेंट वर्कर्स, इट्स बीन दैट वे फॉर ऑलमोस्ट अ डेकेड नाउ। द बल्क ऑफ द माइग्रेंट वर्कर्स कम फॉर कंस्ट्रक्शन एक्टिविटीज एंड मोस्ट ऑफ देम कम फ्रॉम ओडिशा एंड आंध्र प्रदेश, एंड नाउ इट इज एक्सपेंडेड इनटू मैन्युफैक्चरिंग। देयर इज अ सिग्निफिकेंट नंबर ऑफ माइग्रेंट वर्कर्स इन मैन्युफैक्चरिंग as well as in ancillary services of various kinds, from hospitality to hotels to e-shops to all kinds of work, including housekeeping and security services. So the volume of migrant workers has also increased, and also their geographical spread across Tamil Nadu. But even today one can with certainty tell them that the most of the migrant workers are located in the commercial and industrial hubs. So that is like Chennai and its surroundings, Coimbatore. Tirupur is a major draw for because of the garment industry, the clothing industry there. And in the south you have Madurai is one of the sources, and then you have some amount of spread including in, say, for example, towns like Nagapattinam, which is a tourist district, and also a religious pilgrimage center. And you have a lot of migrants doing very, very petty jobs there, like own account work. So from being a very small pocket of labor around Chennai, migrants have come to basically man the entire production terrain of Tamil Nadu, which has become very, very increasingly starkly true when the government is now trying to deal with this whole exodus of migrants back to their home states. Because restarting industries, restarting economic activity seems to be much more difficult in the absence of migrants. Because I think the lockdown was also announced on Monday or Tuesday, and they had not been even paid for a week or 2 weeks before that because of the lack of jobs. So it was immediate. And the government had no clue what to do. Like both the central government and the state government had no clue what to do. And the next thing was the issue of rents that they were facing, because in a couple of weeks, the March became April, and the rents were due, and the workers were getting really troubled by the fact that there would be demands on rent. There were demands on rent, not as much, but there were demands on rent, and that was creating issues. And thirdly, and the government had no answer to that. The government could put on these big rules saying no need to pay rent, etc. But this is not a very streamlined process where the government has actually any say. These are small house owners demanding rent from even weaker migrant sections. And it is all in the informal sector. So nobody has any records of it. Nobody knows who is demanding what. So effectively, the government couldn't do much even in that case. And wage payments for the lockdown period was another major issue. These workers were sitting not because of their own volition, it was not as if they had withdrawn from work, these people wanted work, they were guaranteed work, and yet, because of the government order, they didn't have work. And the companies couldn't pay for the lockdown period. Many companies refused to pay for the lockdown period. And that was another major thing. And eventually, we come to the issue of transport back home, where still states like Tamil Nadu, also, this is not an issue just of Tamil Nadu state. Like, the central government is not very cooperative in this regard, wrangling about the price of trains, etc. The host, the native state, they are unprepared to receive large volumes of workers coming back from COVID-infected areas. And the Tamil Nadu also is not very comfortable or willing to send these workers back because they want to reap that business. So they are also drawing it out. And what it has amounted to is like thousands and thousands of migrant workers willing to take 1,000-kilometer journeys back to Jharkhand, Bengal, Odisha on foot. In this regard, I'm part of a COVID citizens fund for migrant laborers. We set up a helpline on the very first day of the lockdown because we anticipated this would happen. But we never thought that this would be in good scale. We would be called in to work at this scale. So, after a few weeks of this work of calling in to migrant workers to find out what they want, etc., we thought that these needs to be consolidated and the government needs to be notified about what the needs of these workers are. So, we did a survey, and one primary question in that was how many people want to return home? And we came up with another, like our survey revealed that 95% of the workers wanted to go home. And starkly, even 75% of the workers want to go, even if they have jobs, even if jobs come back. Which means, basically, they were not trusting that the jobs would last, and they felt much more comfortable being back home in these trying times of COVID. And it is only natural to expect that people want to go back home in a crisis, especially where there is a lot of threat, both health-wise and financially, in cities like Chennai. And another interesting part of the story was that over 63% of the workers had not been paid wages. Their wages were due. And around less than half of them were being demanded of rent, etc. So, in this scenario, we kind of sent it out to the government. I don't know what effect it had. Did we kind of immediately come up with some reactive parts to it? But it revealed to us a vast threat of wage theft that has happened in the name of COVID. Because there was no reason why people should not have been paid wage for March. I understand the lockdown period, whether you want to pay the wage, not the wage, is a legal tangle, you don't have working capital, etc. But for March, people have worked. And many of them had not received wage. So this has resulted in, over time, a lot of protests across various sites. And the workers have also been protesting against the fact that some of them are not being allowed to go back. One, due to the lack of transportation. Two, because the contractors do not want them to leave. They want to restart businesses, and they think that by holding them back, they will have a large worker base from which to restart and ramp up business and construction activity. So this has created a lot of tension among the workers, and there have been a number of protests. So some of the major ones were in Kudankulam, where a major well-established contractor like L&T was involved, contacting the village, and finally those workers have been sent home. Another case that we came about was L&W. L&W workers are now going back home, but L&W is another major contractor in construction activities. Workers were quite agitated for lack of wage payments and the lack of transportation to go home. They had involved, like, one group had decided to walk. They walked the wrong way, were caught by the police, put into camps, and another group got onto the street, and there was major protests on the streets of Chennai. So, but these things have, in fact, had some effect, because more trains are being allowed, and most of these workers who are brought into these labor camps are being sent back home. Wages remain the problem, especially for small groups. Large groups are able to fight it out. We are able to amplify their voice, put it out on the social media, and some amount of success is possible, but small groups like 4 or 5 people working in hotels, working in shops that have now closed down. In fact, there is an IT company, Bay Area property developers, who have not paid wages. It's been a long-standing fight, and many of the 100-odd workers have not been paid wages. They have returned, and now the Labor Department is insisting that for them to take these cases, they will have to wait till this COVID crisis is over because they don't have manpower to take up these cases. So, these have been the primary struggles for workers in this period, and it was also revealed in our survey. And the government has primarily failed them by not being there at all. Like, this whole COVID crisis has been dealt as some sort of medical emergency, not as a larger social emergency because of the measures that the government has taken. Because when you stop employment, when you are not having proper guidance, you don't want people. We might not have known how many workers are there, like from other states, but we know that it was always a large proportion of the workers. And yet we were not prepared for. And this crisis is also a consequence of what the government had not done for a long period of time, because activists, labor unions, and also researchers have been saying that the registration of migrants are very minimal. They are not being registered fully even under the Interstate Migrant Workers Act. It is an insignificant proportion, and these people need to be brought into the welfare board system or some form of registration system so that we know how many of them are there. But the government dragged its feet all along. And today, if you're surprised about these numbers and unable to frame a scheme or a policy or even allocate funds for it, who is to do? You dragged your feet for 10 years. So, that has been a major problem. And now I think trains are being rashed up because of the pressure that the workers themselves have brought on the government. And it's hope that these issues are resolved soon and people are able to go back home or restart work as they choose.
Thank you.